Stuart Pocock and Bernie Gersh have a great paper in JACC, and it's in the October 14th issue, Do Current Clinical Trials Meet Society's Needs? And it is a critical review of recent evidence. And I am with Stuart J. Pocock, PhD from the Department of Medical Statistics, London School of Hygiene, Tropical Medicine in the UK. First off, a great paper. You're looking at so many different topics within this. We can only touch on a few here. So let's start with the inadequacy of trial research on medical devices.
It's a big problem, especially in Europe. There's a whole history of effective clinical trial, good clinical trials research with drugs. In the States for a long time, it was felt that device trial methodology was like lagging 10 years behind. But the situation is much worse in Europe, that we'd really, to get a new device, cardiovascular device, approved in Europe, you do not have to do randomized trials. You just need to do a short-term registry of a limited number of patients, and the device will likely get approved. So there's inadequate testing of device efficacy and safety in Europe. An example recently is in renal denervation, where they felt that the device for achieving renal denervation to lower blood pressure in patients with resistant hypertension, these devices were approved very rapidly in Europe without proper research. Then one of these devices, the Simplicity one, there was a Simplicity 3 HDN trial, which actually randomized patients to the real device or a sham procedure. And they showed no difference whatsoever in lowering of blood pressure.
And as Tony DiMaria said at the time, he was at the press conference, says, you know, we really need to stop and just go back and start over. And are we really denervating what we think we're denervating?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And as a result, the FDA will naturally not approve renal denervation methods.
Well, fine, here in Europe.
It's out there and being used for no real signs that it's worth doing. And that's what we need to improve in Europe to get proper evidence for approving devices.
What about the second one you deal with is, it's an oldie but a goodie, and that's the trials that are industry sponsored. That's still a challenge after all these years.
And probably always will be. You have a natural conflict between the profit motives of industry. We live in a capitalist society, that's what they're there for, and what clinical trials will be in the best interests of public health and public knowledge. And so we have a continuing need to make sure that the trials for approval of new drugs and devices are still in the best public health interest. And sometimes it goes astray. One example is the drug bivalirudin, where in ACS patients post-PCI, they always compared it with the comparator heparin, but loading the heparin with extra GP2B3A inhibitor. So as a result, the control arm was loaded with extra bleeding risk as a result of adding in the GP2B3A inhibitor. So bivalirudin trials were done to show it was better than that over-toxic combination in many patients. What we now need is a head-to-head trial of bivalirudin versus heparin to see if it really has a place alongside equal use of modest use of GP2B3A inhibitors.
Are you talking about
that's one example.
You talk about the need for more head-to-head trials, but we're going to get fewer and fewer of those because we're starting to look at pragmatic trials and the interventional effectiveness studies, that observational studies. We're seeing more and more of those.
Well, you can do head-to-head trials, like there's one publicly funded trial of ticagrelor versus prasugrel. So it can be done, but there's not enough of them. So I'm not going to let that one go without saying it can be done. But back to your other point about strategic trials, that we get trials comparing very similar regimens often. Yes, drug A versus drug B, or drug A versus placebo, they're easy to do, and you can enroll lots of patients, generally speaking. Whereas often what clinical trials need to tackle is whole differences of strategy to patient management. So take patients with aortic valve disease. Should they be getting standard aortic valve surgery, or should they be getting a modern TAVI, which requires much less invasive actions on the patient? And those kind of strategy trials need to happen more often.
So, I mean, by the title, do current clinical trials meet society's needs? Obviously, in some cases, no. Overall, how would you answer that question that you pose yourself in the paper with Dr. Gersh?
Well, in cardiology, we're doing better than most other disease areas, actually. So there've been a huge amount of success stories in cardiology. But the last thing we should do is be complacent. That often that we are doing the trials that make money, not the trials that actually enhance, truly enhance patient care. So I think the final message must try harder to get the right actions going.
I mean, in theory, some of the government funding can be hopefully done in those areas, can promote those kinds of trials where it's hard to get funding for.
Yeah, but there's not enough money around. Yeah. Government funding is just not enough. We need to get more government funding in the direction of the trials that are needed.
Yeah. The paper is from Dr. Gersh and Dr. Pocock, and it really is a fascinating look at the issue. And it's the issue of JACC for October 14th. For CardioSource World News, I'm Executive Editor Rick McGuire.